So we saw at the end of our last session together that the virus is faced with a consequence of using the host RNA polymerase II to copy its genome back from the DNA form into RNA, and that is that the RNA polymerase II hitches onto a part of the gene, an essential part of the gene called the promoter, scans around, looks for an RNA initiation site, copies the RNA to a site that is upstream from the end of the DNA gene, and that's the RNA. And that RNA is good for coding for protein in translation, but it's not good to be a new gene when it's copied back again into DNA. So there's this big problem. It lacks the control sequences. So it doesn't copy these essential parts of a DNA gene. And so the question is, how on earth does that therefore produce a new virus when faced with these problems? Now, what it could do is integrate that copy of the DNA into another gene and use other genes, control sequences, enhancers, promoters, RNA initiation site, RNA termination site as its own. It'd be extremely difficult to do. It might be able to do it, might be one day hit upon the right site, but it's not going to do that. And if it doesn't do that, it's got to provide its own promoters and its own RNA initiation site and its own enhancers and its own RNA termination site. But as I said, they're not copied. The clue as to how this happens comes from a not-so-subtle difference between the RNA version of the virus and the DNA version of the virus. Now, as we've already said, the RNA version of the virus has three genes, GAG, POL, and ENV. That's all you need to make the proteins of the virus. At either end, there are some sequences in the virus that are not copied. Sorry, that are not used. They are copied. They're not used to make protein. There's a repeat region at each end called the R region. It stands for repeat. And then in between, at this the 5' end of the RNA, between the R region and the GAG gene, there's a unique sequence called U5. Down here at the 3' end, there's a unique sequence called U3. Now, when we look at the DNA, what we see is that that U5 has become duplicated, and it's over here. That U3 near the 3' end of the RNA has become duplicated, and it's over here. So now what you've got is a longer DNA form than the RNA form, and you've got two repeat sequences at either end that are larger than the original repeats, because the end goes U3RU5, and these are known as the long terminal repeats. So what's happened is that the reverse transcriptase in making the DNA form has copied that U3 region over to here, and then copied the rest of the RNA, and then copied the U5 region and put it over here. So this is not just simple linear copying of one strand of nucleic acid into another. It's clearly much more complicated than that. Now, I don't want to go into how that happens. This really is complicated. Some years ago, I made a little movie of how this happens. Should you really be interested in this? Doesn't look like the eyes are lighting up here of extraordinary interest. But should you be really interested, go to the website and look at the movie. It's absolutely fascinating how it works. But for our purposes, suffice it to say that the RNA form of the virus is smaller than the DNA form of the virus by virtue of the fact that during reverse transcription, these internal sequences get copied and put at the other ends. So what happens? It turns out that in this site over here, this U3 site over here, in the RNA, there happens to be a rather nice RNA initiation site buried here. It also happens that in this U5 region, there's a rather nice RNA termination site. Also, in this U3 region, there's a nice set of promoters. They don't do anything here in the RNA form, but now, during this replication process, they're just at the right place to act as promoters for the RNA polymerase 2 to leap on and copy. So here's the RNA polymerase 2. It leapt onto that promoter that was buried here in the RNA, now down in the right place. The RNA polymerase 2 goes on. It looks at for an RNA initiation site, which just happens to be in the U3 at exactly the right place so that it comes at the beginning of the R, copies it down there, finds a termination site, and look what's happened. You've got a faithful copy of the RNA again. So by having internal promoters, which don't function in RNA, and internal enhancers, and internal RNA initiation and termination sites, and then putting them at the right place during reverse transcription, you now set the DNA up for faithful copying back into RNA using this host cell enzyme. Now that is just unbelievably incredible. So, the fact that you have the promoter buried in that little cassette of information, the U3, which you stick up here at the right end here, means that there can only be one initiation site. That means that there can only be one RNA. See, all of these things have consequences. There can only be one RNA. That means that you're going to have to make messenger RNA by cutting up that RNA. And therefore, the genomic RNA must be the same sense as RNA, therefore, it must be positive sense, and therefore, all retroviruses are positive sense RNA viruses. It's just that fact that all of these RNA viruses, these retroviruses, are positive strand RNA viruses, positive strand RNA viruses, flows from the consequences of this replication mechanism. And that says what I just said. So here's our typical retrovirus again. In the RNA form, it's got that repeat region, the U3, the U5, and those three genes. All that's necessary, we've seen now, to make a new genome, new viral structural proteins, a new virus. The very first retrovirus that was discovered as a tumor virus. It wasn't known to be a retrovirus at the time that this tumor virus was discovered. It was Rous sarcoma virus. And this causes a sarcoma in chickens, and it can sweep through a chicken flock very, very quickly. I mean, chickens are kept in farms these days very, very close together. This can sweep through a chicken flock very, very easily. So this is a virus, a retrovirus, a Rous sarcoma virus, that causes rapid, acute, spreading sarcomas in chickens. And when people discovered this virus itself, and found out it was a retrovirus, and looked at its structure, they found it had an extra gene. And they called it SARC by the fact that this is the gene that causes the sarcoma. This is the oncogene. Now look, in contrast, to the DNA tumor viruses, this is an extra gene. And this is a gene that this retrovirus has picked up from a chicken some stage during its evolution. It's not necessary to make new virus. But it confers upon this virus the property of being able to stimulate cells into rapid cell division, rapid DNA duplication, which is a great advantage as an environment to the replication of virus. So Rous sarcoma virus here has this extra oncogene that allows it to cause sarcomas, rapidly proliferating sarcomas in chickens. And you find these extra oncogenes, they all have a three-letter name. You've probably heard of MYC, that gets in the news occasionally. And some of these genes are actually replace other genes. For example, here, this virus here, avian myeloblastosis virus, has lost its envelope gene and acquired this extra gene, MYB. And here's feline sarcoma virus. It's a pretty pathetic virus. It has what it needs in terms of R and U5 to replicate itself, but it's lost almost all of its three genes and is just a couple of repeat sequences and U5 surrounding an oncogene. Now, this guy here and this guy here, avian myelosarcoma virus, which has also lost its functional genes, can't replicate itself unless it has a helper virus to provide the gag, the pollen, the end. So these only exist because cells get infected by more than one type of virus, the other virus, a type of retrovirus, the other retrovirus producing the virus, the proteins that are necessary to make new baby viruses. But here we see in these chronic transformers that they've picked up an extra gene, sometimes to the detriment of their own viral genes, that allow them to transform cells. And these genes are the oncogenes. And so they're viral oncogenes. And you've heard some of this now, what I'm going to talk about, but we'll just go through it briefly, from Dr. Patton in the pathology course. That there are cellular proto-oncogenes that are homologs of these viral oncogenes, because these are genes that we know were picked up from the host animal. There are retroviruses around that have picked up our genes. Rouse sarcoma virus picked up this SARC gene from a chicken, some stage, and allowed it to have an evolutionary advantage of being a tumor virus. So there are all of these retroviral oncogenes have a homolog in us or in their host animal. And so there are these cellular proto-oncogenes also. And Jeff, I know, told you something about that. So a proto-oncogene in us, in the normator, is a cellular or host gene that is homologous with a similar gene found in a transforming virus. And it's not normally tumorigenic because we all have these genes. We express them during our development when we were just a little bit post being a gleam in one's father's eye when we were developing in utero. These genes were switched on during our normal development. And these cellular oncogenes get switched off and then they come back on again at various important parts of our development, our life cycle. They're important genes for us. We wouldn't be here if we didn't have these genes and they weren't functioning properly. But after transformation, they can then cause tumors in us as well. So it was the discovery of these retroviral oncogenes that led to the discovery of proto-oncogenes in our normal genome that also cause cancers, non-virally induced cancers in us and in other animals. So that explains, these oncogenes explain how the acutely transforming retroviruses cause cancers. They have picked up a DNA or otherwise proliferation controlling gene, put it into a new context in the virus, and then it goes berserk when it's in the virus and causes unrestricted cellular proliferation. And these, in the laboratory, cause these very acute, rapid transformations. Now, in contrast, there's a set of retroviruses that cause chronic tumors in us, and in animals. And these cause the formation of tumors after a very long time, as opposed to the Rouse sarcoma virus, where it just spreads through the chicken flock. These are the chronic transformers. And when people looked at avian mucosis virus as an archetypal virus for this, they had a surprise, because this is a tumor retrovirus, a tumor-causing retrovirus, and it has no oncogene. So how does it cause a tumor? When we look at a tumor in a bird that has been infected with ALV, the ALV can just jump into the genome like all of these retroviruses can, all over the place. But when you look at the tumor, it's clear the tumor is clonal. The retrovirus in the tumor cells is always at one or a very restricted number of places in the host cell's genome. And so clearly it is able to produce a tumor without having an oncogene in its genome because of the context in which it finds itself in the host cell. So there must be something about this crucial transforming event. There must be something very, very important about where that virus ended up, that in the absence of its own oncogene allows it to cause a transformed cell and a tumor. So what's special about that site where it inserted itself? They're all close to a cellular oncogene, in this case, c-MYC. And this is what we call oncogenesis by promoter insertion. What's happened here is that normal gene, the host cell MYC gene, which was involved in your and my development during embryogenesis and is involved in many cells control of their DNA synthesis, has now had a virus inserted next to it, which has an LTR. And an LTR is a promoter that is designed for super transcription. So suddenly, a virus pops in next to the c-MYC gene. The c-MYC gene has probably been turned off for a long, long time because it's not needed, because we're not duplicating all of our cells all of the time. That promoter, that super promoter in the LTR, now is located close to this oncogene. It gets switched on and the cell starts to divide. Simple as that. Oncogenesis by promoter insertion. The virus probably inserted itself many places, but unless it finds itself next to an oncogene, a cellular oncogene, one of these DNA controlling genes, one of these embryogenesis controlling genes, then it's not going to do anything. But once it puts that LTR that is designed for making lots and lots of copies of a gene, then the c-MYC, in this case, gets switched on, and you get uncontrolled cell DNA replication. Okay? So the question has often come up, and the answer to this is yes. Can they be involved? Can c-ONCs be involved in non-viral cancers? And the answer, of course, is that is yes. There are about 40 of these cellular proto-oncogenes that, under the right circumstances, can be altered in non-viral cancers to give a tumor. And they, as you might expect, encode things like growth factors, transcription factors, various signal transduction proteins. So that brings us to the end of retroviruses. And knowing now about oncogenes and these other things like MYC and the cellular proto-oncogenes, we can go back to the DNA tumor viruses. And we'll start off with herpes. Now, you remember that I said that herpes is a DNA tumor virus, well-known causative agent of a number of human cancers. Epstein-Barr virus, in Burkitt's lymphoma, human herpes virus 8, in Kaposi's sarcoma, and there are others. It's a DNA tumor virus. Now, this picture up here is just to remind me to tell you, of course, that we know where all the genes are on the human karyotype, on the human chromosomes here. We know where they are. We know where these proto-oncogenes, these normal cellular genes that are involved in controlled cellular differentiation and replication. We know where they are. This one, our friend we just met, MYC, he's over here on chromosome 8. Another one over here, which is involved in feline sarcoma. When this gene is carried by a retrovirus, it can cause feline sarcoma. That's over here on chromosome 15. These are the locations of the normal cellular proto-oncogenes that we use at some stage in our developmental cycle. Now, very characteristic. In fact, it's so characteristic, it's actually used in the lab for identification of virus for diagnosis. And many of these things are indeed used for diagnosis in these cases. Here, in Burkitt's lymphoma, when you look at the karyotype of the cells in the tumor, you see that very frequently there is an 8 to 14 translocation. You get a break here on chromosome 14 and the swapping over with a little bit here of chromosome 8. Now, I couldn't find a good picture of this for Burkitt's lymphoma, but here in acute myelocytic leukemia, you can see certain chromosomes, this one here by the arrow, you see it's blue at one end and it's yellow at the other end. And you can see some other ones here. Here's one that's got three colors, blue, green, and red. And these are chromosomes that have become broken and then reformed into abnormal hybrid chromosomes. And they seem to be the basis of why this is a leukemic cell. Now, here, as I said, in Burkitt's lymphoma, this herpes virus-controlled cancer. And remember we said that herpes has this hit-and-run mechanism. It seems to go in, do the dirty deed, and leave. It causes these breaks and the translocation of bits of chromosome 8 over to 14, in many cases. You heard things, for example, you've heard of Philadelphia chromosome in certain diseases. That's also one of these translocations. Here, there is this translocation of this bit over here to this and vice versa. So the question is, what is over there in 14? Now remember, this is Burkitt's lymphoma. It's a B cell lymphoma. So it's only going on in B cells. The other cells aren't proliferating. Well, it turns out that that MYC gene, that normal cellular MYC gene, during this translocation is being brought right up adjacent to the IG heavy chain promoter. And that explains why this is a B cell lymphoma. Because in B cells, in many B cells, that is a highly active promoter causing the production of immunoglobulins. So by bringing the MYC next to the immunoglobulin promoter, you switch it aberrantly on. And since MYC is involved in DNA replication, the cell responds by replicating its DNA, dividing, forms tumor. Now, in certain forms of Burkitt's lymphoma, you see an 8-2 translocation. And lo and behold, the MYC, same MYC gene there is being brought up against the light cell, the light chain, rather, promoter, light IG promoter, light chain IG promoter. See? And there are other situations here where cells get their chromosomes broken and reformed here, for example, in B-cell chronic lymphocytic leukemia. Here's an oncogene called BCL1 that's brought up against the IG heavy chain promoter. And when that cell is switched on to make immunoglobulin heavy chains, then it makes MYC instead, and as a result, the cell's DNA metabolism gets altered. So this is oncogenesis by rearrangement, and it's caused by the presence of a DNA tumor virus, herpes virus, that seems to have this capacity to break chromosomes and allow them to reform. Why it does that, how it does that, is somewhat obscure, but it does have this effect, and it leads to common human cancers. Okay, small DNA viruses. We don't need to go into too much detail about this because we're running out of time. Mutations in proto-oncogenes that you've seen about MYC and these kind of things, they tend to be dominant mutations. You only have to have one of the genes altered to get tumorigenesis. But there are certain other classes of genes, oncogenic genes that show recessive, which show a recessive character, where you have to have both copies of the gene altered to get tumorigenesis. These are called anti-oncogenes, and they are tumor suppressor genes. And the most famous ones of these are retinoblastoma, RB gene, and P53. Now, I don't want to go into much detail on these, but they are also of great consequences in cancer. And they tell us how those small DNA tumor viruses that we started talking about at the very beginning of this session work. And we had to know all this about oncogenes and MYC and all that kind of stuff before we could explain what's going on here. Now, in the case of the small DNA tumor viruses, the polyomas, the adenos, the papillomas, they work by altering the function of these tumor suppressor genes. And the retinoblastoma genes involved in, not only in retinoblastoma, but a large number of other cancers. P53 is involved in a large number of cancers by deletion and point mutation, but also it's involved in these virally induced cancers. Now, remember what I said in our summary slide earlier, that adenovirus, SV40, polyoma BK, which is another polyoma, a large number of these other papillomas here, the genes they switch on when they transform a cell are the early functions, not the structural genes. That is a common finding with all of these small DNA viruses. And all of these proteins here have a sequence in common that, if you mutate it, renders the virus non-tumorigenic. Now, what's happening in here, an adenovirus cell, is quite simple. Normally, the RB gene causes the production of RB protein, and that RB protein stops the replication of DNA. Okay? That cell doesn't, the virus, when it comes in, doesn't like that situation of DNA synthesis suppression. So it wants to stop RB protein carrying out its function. Here's adenovirus, that E1A gene. It produces the E1A protein. The E1A protein binds to RB protein and stops it binding to the DNA, and the cell cycle then continues. Same goes for the P53. Here is hepatitis C virus, which also can cause hepatocellular carcinoma, and our good friend here, the papillomavirus here, and here's the P53. The P53 binds to DNA, stops its replication. It's actually a lot more complicated than this. Again, should the non-understandable thing strike you that you want to read more about this, go to the website. P53 gene causes the production of P53 protein. Again, a tumor suppressor protein. It stops DNA replication. Hepatitis C produces a protein that binds P53, stops it binding to the DNA, replication occurs. In the case of our good friends, the papillomaviruses, they produce a protease that proteolyzes specifically P53, chops it up into little bits, can't bind onto the DNA, therefore replication proceeds and sets the cell up for the production of DNA, and in the case of the virus, viral DNA. Okay, so it was the first tumor viruses to be discovered were these small DNA tumor viruses. We knew also something about herpes viruses, that they caused DNA, they caused tumors. They are DNA viruses. They're large DNA viruses. Then we discovered about retroviruses and how they work and how their tumorigenic potential is involved with these viral oncogenes like SARC and MYC. And knowing that, then people discovered that there were certain oncogenes which were tumor suppressor genes. And that then explained to us how the DNA viruses work. So that's why we've taken this route from DNA to RNA back to DNA viruses again. Okay. So that now takes us around to the end of our first session together. And if I close that, and I start on.